We're going to look at solving equations with square roots. And we'll do exactly these four steps in each example. Step one will be to isolate the square root. We'll see exactly what that means. Squaring both sides of the equation is what will eliminate that square root, as long as we've isolated it. We'll solve the new equation that has no radicals in it. And a new important step is to check the solutions from the new equation and see which ones worked in the original. After I've done the two examples, I'll talk a little bit about what's important about this step here, squaring both sides of the equation, and why we have to check the solutions now. This is no longer just a recommendation. We must do that. It's called the squaring property of equality. But let's look at how we use this process first. Step one, isolate the square root. In this example, the square root is already isolated. Sitting all by itself on the left side of the equation. This entire expression is already sitting under the radical, so there's nothing outside the radical. No other terms, no coefficient. So we can move on to step two, square both sides of the equation. So just rewrite this. So we're going to square the entire left side and the right side. Now, as long as there's just a single square root sitting inside the parentheses here, then this square will cancel the square root. That's true by the definition of the square root. And what that means for us is you get whatever expression you had in underneath the radical is exactly what comes out when you simplify the square. The right side is just going to be 6 squared, which is 36. So here's our new equation, and we're going to solve that by simply adding 3 to both sides. This is a nice linear equation. And now divide by 2. Now we're trying to isolate x. And we get x equals 39 halves. So that's the end of step 3, solving the new equation. Step 4. Very important, we must check to see if this solution also works in the original equation. And I've worked that out for you. 39 halves was our potential solution. Plugging it in for x in this equation. This one works out nicely. The 2's cancel here, so we don't even need a common denominator. 39 minus 3, square root of 36 is 6. The right side is also 6. This works. That means we get a true statement when we plug this value in. That makes 39 halves a solution to this equation. If it had not worked, we would have just crossed it out and said no solutions. Let's try another example. Square root of x plus 4. Plus 2 equals x. Now when you consider step 1, isolate the square root, we can see we actually have some work to do. Here's the square root with the x plus 4. There's a plus 2 sitting outside. If you did not isolate this, if you squared both sides at this point, one of two things would happen. Either you would make a common mistake and try to square each piece separately, which you absolutely cannot do. Or if you did it correctly, you would, since there's really two unlike terms here, you would square that like a binomial. You'd have to really FOIL the whole thing out, and you would see that you would not eliminate the radical. You would still be left with a square root. So step one is very important here. We need to isolate this by subtracting the 2 from both sides. Now we're left with the square root of x plus 4 on the left and x minus 2 on the right. Now we can move on to step 2 and square both sides of this equation. So on the left side, the square is going to cancel the square root, and we're just left with the expression x plus 4. And the right side, well, here we have an actual binomial squared. I won't fill in all the details of this, but you will have to FOIL that out. Look at all your products here, and that'll end up being x squared minus 4x plus 4. The left side was still x plus 4. This is a quadratic equation because I've got an x squared and an x and a constant. Another x, another constant. So we're going to put everything on one side of the equation. I like my x squared term to be positive, whether I factor or use the quadratic formula. So let me subtract to move terms to the right side of the equation. So we end up with 0 on the left, and on the right side I have x squared minus 5x, and the 4 minus 4 is 0. X squared minus 5x actually factors very easily. You just factor out an x. It's important that we have the 0 over here on the other side because we're going to use the 0 product rule. Either x equals 0 or x minus 5 equals 0. And that gives us x equals 0, x equals 5. Step 3 was a little bit more work this time. After we squared both sides, we had to solve a quadratic equation. And now, step 4, we must check these two solutions to see which of them, if either, maybe both, but we need to check them to see which ones work in this original equation. And again, I have worked that out for you. X equals 0 was the first. I'm going to plug that in for both of the x's in this equation. You can see how that works out. 0 plus 4, square root of 4 is 2. We get 4 on the left, 0 on the right. X equals 0 gives us a false statement, so that is not a solution to the equation. X equals 5, on the other hand, 5 plus 4, square root of 9, 3 plus 2 on the left, 5 on the right, 5 equals 5, that's true. So 5 is a solution, 5 is a solution, 0 is not a solution. So I would cross out the 0 and only list 5 as the solution to the equation that we started with. All right, so that wraps up the two examples. You can see this that we used the exact same steps. You probably won't get anything much more complicated than a quadratic equation here to solve. What's important, what I want to talk about now, is how this idea of squaring both sides of the equation, how that sort of fits in with our big picture of solving equations. And hopefully it'll help you understand why we have to check the answers. So remember that till now we've used two properties of equality, the addition property of equality and the multiplication property of equality. And what those allowed us to do was either add or subtract the same number or term from both sides of an equation. I'm going to include subtraction in this property as well. So what this double arrow here means is that the two equations are equivalent, starting with A equals B, and adding C to both sides. Equivalent means they have the same solutions. So if one is true, then the other is true, and vice versa. So you get the double arrow. Same thing with multiplication. If you start with an equation, you can multiply both sides by a non-zero number or term, and that will give you an equivalent equation. You can also divide both sides by a non-zero number or term. The reason you can't multiply by zero on both sides is because that'll turn whatever you started with into zero equals zero, and that will usually not be equivalent to what you started with. What we're interested in is, can we square both sides of an equation? So if I start with A equals B, and I square both sides, does that give me an equivalent equation? Equivalent means same solutions. Well, if you think about the examples that we just did, the answer is no. In particular, the last example. Here's what I had after I subtracted the 2 from both sides of the equation. And remember, subtracting 2 from both sides creates an equivalent equation. So this equation has the same solutions as the one I started with, and the only solution for that was 5. And you can check that very easily here. Square root of 9 on the left would be 3. 5 minus 2 on the right would also be 3. When I squared both sides of that equation, I of course had to solve this quadratic equation, but what I came up with were two solutions, 0 and 5. So here's an equation, a equals b, with one solution. Here's the equation a squared equals b squared, with that solution plus another. So the idea is, when you square both sides of an equation, whatever solutions there were from the original equation will still be there, but you may pick up additional solutions. A really simple example would just be something like x equals 3. Square both sides, you get x squared equals 9. The first equation just has the solution 3. That's easy to see. And the second equation has two solutions, 3 and negative 3. So the idea, or the squaring property that we were asking about, can be stated, if you want to use the arrows that we were using for addition and multiplication, a equals b implies a squared equals b squared. If this equation is true, then a squared equals b squared will also be true, but not necessarily vice versa. In terms of solutions, it means any solutions of the first equation will also be solutions of the second, but not necessarily the other way around. And for us, practically speaking, it means that when we solve this new equation, after we've gotten rid of the radical, we get a list of possible solutions for the first equation. So you have to check them.